Hi, I'm Chris Cooper. Thanks for joining us. Today on The Family Plot, we're going to give you some tips on growing your own strawberries, and we'll find out about caring for roses. That's just ahead on The Family Plot, Gardening in the Mid-South, so stay with us.
This is a production of WKNO Memphis. Production funding for The Family Plot, Gardening in the Mid-South is provided by Goodwin's Landscape and Garden Center in Germantown since 1943 and continuing to offer its plants for successful gardening with 7 greenhouses and 3 acres of plants, plus comprehensive landscape services. Goodwin's Landscape and Garden Center. The WKNO Production Fund, the WKNO Endowment Fund, and by viewers like you. Thank you.
Hi, welcome to The Family Plot. I'm Chris Cooper. Joining me today is UT Extension Agent Mike Dennison. How are you doing today, Mr. Day?
Doing good, Chris.
Good. And Jimmy Moser. Jimmy is a rosarian, and I understand that you have over 700 roses in your yard.
I do.
You do. Well, good, Mr. Jimmy. We're going to dive right into it. First thing first, what is a rosarian?
Well, a rosarian is simply a person that grows and raises roses,
okay.
Works in roses.
Okay. All right. Now, you work a lot with roses, okay?
I do.
And I'm pretty sure coming up in the next couple of weeks here, we're going to have Mother's Day, so there's going to be a lot of people buying roses.
The top selling day of the year for roses.
Mother's Day.
Mother's Day.
How about that? So I need to remember that for my own mother.
I would have figured it was Valentine's
Day. I would have, too.
Now, let's cut roses up.
Okay, it's good to know. Well, look, let's talk about planting roses. What are some of the basic tips that people need to know about when it comes time to growing roses?
First, you need to buy a good bush to start with.
Okay.
And the local nurseries are an excellent place to buy. If you order mail order, it also, you buy them bare root. They're a little bit more hard to work with.
Okay.
But if you can buy them locally on a potted rose, they're very simple. You dig a nice hole.
Okay.
Bigger than this pot.
Okay.
You, the only fertilization you use when planting that rose is to put either bone meal or superphosphate in the hole. No fertilization until they leaf out.
Okay.
And then after you get it out of the pot, the best to cut the pot off with a knife and not disturb the root system.
Okay.
And after you do that, start working your soil back in around the bush, put your superphosphate or your bone meal or in a circle around the bush. Finish filling it with dirt, soak it in with water, and keep it wet.
Okay. Now, would you need to amend our clay soils with
Absolutely.
Anything? Okay.
You need a soil base. We tell people with a third topsoil, a third sand, and a third humus of some soil, the soil mixture that you use to grow excellent roses.
Okay. And I guess that works pretty well with drainage.
Drainage, your best bet in drainage in this area is we have such a heavy, hard clay soil, is to use a raised bed. And in that raised bed, you need to go 3 landscape timbers high or 4, cross ties or blocks or whatever you have. Raise it up off the ground. That way you can get good drainage. Use your same soil mix, a third sand, a third topsoil, and a third humus. And most of these landscape people have that mixture that they'll mix up for you.
Okay, so they'll be able to find it out. Okay, what about mulch? Do you mulch your roses?
You need to mulch them later on, usually about May after the weather starts warming up. You can use several things to mulch with. I use pine straw, I use crushed leaves. Horse manure is excellent if you can find horse manure.
Okay.
I used to use rabbit manure, which there's not many rabbits around anymore, so that's a thing of the past. But right now I'm using pine straw and chopped up oak leaves, which I have an abundance of in my yard.
Okay. Do you chop up your oak leaves to
incorporate them into? Yes, chop them up. It's better to chop them up. They break down a lot faster.
Okay. And for that horse manure, we want to make sure that it's compost.
Not necessarily.
Not necessarily? How
no,
about
sir.
That?
Okay. We tell the people, out of the horse, into the truck, onto the bed.
Oh, that's good. Learn something new. Okay. Into the bed. I like that. Let's talk a bit again about feeding our roses. Now, what do you like to feed your roses with?
Okay. There's several other things you can do. In the springtime, after I prune my roses back, I fertilize with this program. I use a cup of some kind of organic fertilizer.
Okay.
Mills Magic Rose Mix is an excellent one. I'll use a cup of gypsum around each bush. That gives them lime, gives them calcium. I'll use 3 tablespoons of urea, 3 tablespoons of Epsom salt. Scratch it in the soil and water it in real good. Wow. That'll give you a good start on your bushes.
Give you a good start.
Right.
Okay, sounds good. I have actually 8 rose bushes at home, and I need to go back and do some feeding. Maybe mine would grow a lot better if I did that. Now, let's talk about some common problems with diseases and pests.
Okay, okay. Most common problem that you have with roses in this area is black spot. Okay, another problem is powdery mildew. And black spot, in taking care of roses, it's always prevention rather than a cure. Once you have black spot, you cannot cure it. You can kill it, but you cannot... cure it.
Okay.
And what you need to do is to spray your roses on a weekly basis with a product called Manzate, which will kill the black spot or prevent it. And also we use a product called Bannermax, which is lasts for 2 weeks. One is contact poison, the other systemic poison. One works within the plant, one works on the surface of the plant.
Okay.
You get good control that way. But you have to be diligent. Do it on a weekly or a bi-weekly manner.
Okay, and make sure you read the label on it also.
Absolutely.
It'll pretty much tell you on the label.
Anything you use, you read the label first.
Read the label first. That's right. Now, what about some pests?
We have a lot of pest problems. Right now, when your blooms first start opening, you have thrips. Mm-hmm. And if you'll see a rose open, it's got black edges on it. When it opens up, that's thrips. It's a little tiny micro bug almost, but they damage your roses when they first start showing color on the bud. You need to mist your buds with some kind of type of pesticide on about every 3 day for these cycle of thrips. We also have a cucumber beetle, which I use a product called Tall Star with the cucumber beetles. They eat holes in your petals, and I do show roses, and if you got a hole in a petal, you can throw that bloom away as far as show purpose goes. Another problem that we have is spider mites.
Okay.
Spider mites, if you'll look at your bottom of your bushes, they usually come up from the bottom. You'll have a rusty looking starting leaves. If you look underneath the leaves, it's kind of sandy. There'll be a little web, and then they will actually defoliate a bush. So, you can cure it if you just have a few roses with a real strong stream of water about every 30 days. Wash the underside of the bushes. We'll take care of your spider mites.
Wow.
Shoot.
So rose bushes take a lot of work.
A lot of work, a lot of pleasure.
Yes, a lot of pleasure.
You get a lot out of it. No other flower you can have blooms from May to November like you do on a rose bush. It's a lot of work, but it's a lot of pleasure.
Yes.
It's a lot of beauty.
Pretty and smell real good.
Right. Some of them are fragrant.
Now, this is a typical question that we get here, Mr. Jimmy. It's, when should you cut back your roses?
Okay, we prune our roses back usually around Washington Day, Washington's birthday in February, in the springtime. And that time, that's when you put out this initial fertilizer I was talking about. You can prune them back to 12 inches, or you can prune them back to 2 foot. The higher they are, the more blooms you'll have. The lower you cut them, the better bloom you'll have.
Okay. All right, good deal. Well, I cut mine pretty low, so I'm looking for some good blooms. I already have some good blooms on my roses. Now, do you prune a climbing rose the same way you would a regular rose?
Okay. Do not. Okay. Usually on a climbing rose, and some of them are one-time bloomers, if you prune them in the spring, you won't have any blooms that year. Usually we tell people to prune their roses after they bloom, a climber.
Okay.
Let them bloom first and then prune them back. And then you'll start to see growth come after the first bloom cycle and grow a bigger bush, and then you go from there.
Okay. Now, how far down the stem do you cut the cut your roses when you're deadheading?
Okay, if you're deadheading the roses after they bloom, you want to cut the old bloom off. You want to go to the second 5-leaf. There's five petals on a leaf. Go back to the second 5-leaf, cut it at an angle, and that's where you get new growth, and then your next bloom will start.
Oh, okay. So second 5-leaf.
Yes.
Okay.
That way you get to a stronger stem.
Okay.
The main reason, and have a better bloom.
Okay, good deal. Now, I'm pretty sure you get this question a lot. People want easy roses. They want roses they don't have to care for. They just want to put them out in the yard and let them go.
Knockouts. That's the number one seller in roses right now. They're trouble-free. You set them out, fertilize them, forget about them. All you need to do is to cut the cut the old blooms off, and they keep blooming all year round. A lot of people are replacing their azaleas with knockouts because you get a year-round bloom, where on azalea you get a one-time flush.
All right, sounds good. Knockouts.
And there are a lot of different knockouts.
Okay.
There's pink ones, there's red ones, so there's a double petal, double knockouts they call. There's a sunny knockout, there's a rainbow knockout, and there's a lot of knockout varieties.
Okay.
There's another one that's called trouble-free like that. It's called home run. And it's a red one with yellow eyes. And if you go over here to Folks Folly, there's a whole yard full of them there I've set up.
Okay, we're about to check that out. A lot of different knockout roses out there.
They're trouble-free.
Trouble-free.
If you're going to start roses and want roses, that's the way to go.
Knockouts are the way to go. All right, well, look, let's transition to talk about strawberries.
Okay.
All right, Mr. D. How do we get started with strawberries?
Strawberries are ripe now. We actually are commercial growers. We have Jones Orchard has a planting out at Agri Center and at their location on Highway 51 North. So the best way to get started is to go buy you some and eat them, I guess. The strawberries that we're harvesting right now were planted back in the fall. Our commercial growers grow strawberries as if they're an annual plant. Mm-hmm. However, strawberries are perennials and they will grow from year to year. Mm-hmm. However, the strawberries that are produced on the daughter plants are never as big as the strawberries that were produced on the original mother plant. Mm-hmm. So our commercial growers treat them as an annual plant, and they will get one crop off of them, and then they may, at the end of the season, June, mid-June, when it gets real hot, the strawberries will pretty much play out, and they'll kill those strawberries back and then plant vegetables, pumpkins and things like that on those beds.
Okay.
So now is not the time to plant strawberries. Just eat them and enjoy them now. If you want to plant some this fall, there's several varieties that do well in our area. The old variety is Cardinal. Cardinal still does well in this area. The California varieties like Chandler, Pajaro, and Douglas do well in our area also. But what our commercial growers are growing now with great success are the Sweet Charlie, Camarosa. Those are varieties of strawberries that do well.
Okay. Now, what kind of soil conditions do strawberries need to thrive in?
Soil, strawberries need a high pH, pH between 6, 6.5. They don't like wet feet. Mm-hmm. That's why you see the strawberries on raised beds. Do well like roses. They do well in the same type of soil as roses, as a matter of fact. If you're wanting to plant them in your landscape, and that's a good idea. Edible landscaping is good, and you can throw you some strawberries in your landscape and do pretty good with them. But well-drained soil with a high pH is best.
With a high pH. And what about growing strawberries in containers?
That will work. It's going to take a little bit more moisture management. Mm-hmm. You'll have to, pay a lot more attention, to the water. Even in a landscape or commercial growers, our commercial growers have a trickle irrigation system under that black plastic where they're providing plenty of moisture for the strawberries. And, strawberries is in a hanging basket, another edible landscaping that does well.
Okay. Now, what about some strawberry pests?
Strawberries, the main pest of strawberries in our area is a fungus disease called gray mold. Mm-hmm. Pretty devastating during wet conditions. So the strawberry growers usually have to use fungicides to control gray mold. There are other more minor pests that are out there. I think we may have some pictures. That's the gray mold right there. Mm-hmm. That is a real problem. And the bad thing about those, if you have strawberries that have that fungal disease, you've got to pick them off and get rid of them. And it's no fun picking rotten strawberries. You got to pick them and you got to throw them away and get rid of them because it can spread from that fruit to the healthy fruit. But some of the other diseases, I know there's a crown blight or a crown borer, an insect, that if that shows up on some strawberry plants that you planted, I would let the supplier know that there's a problem and there's actually absolutely nothing you can do about it.
Right.
And it'll wipe the plant out.
And we have a picture of that right now.
I think
that
you do.
Yeah.
That's the crown borer. That's the actual insect. You don't normally see that. You see a dead plant, and if you look down at the base of the plant or the crown of the plant, you'll see where that insect is bored into the plant, and you'll see frass and and excrement and things like that that's coming out of the hole that it bored into, but the plant is pretty much dead, and absolutely nothing you can do about that. Not that common a sight.
Oh, it's not that common. Okay. So pretty much the mold is
the fungus disease is the main problem. You know, there's some beetle. There's a seed beetle that you'll see on strawberries, a little bitty tiny beetle that feeds on the seeds that actually it doesn't hurt the strawberries. It's almost helping produce a seedless strawberry, you know, because the little seeds, the little brown seeds on the strawberry are, you know, they get stuck in your teeth and that can be a problem. But there are a few other insects that you'll see from time to time, but not normally a problem. My commercial growers don't normally have to do a lot of insecticide applications for their strawberries, mainly the fungus disease. The gray spot, gray mold is the main problem.
Okay, and I guess this last question is a common question, is how do you keep your strawberries alive for that second year?
Well, now that's, if you're doing that, if you're growing strawberries as a perennial, it's really not a problem. You need to do a good job of mulching. You need to do a good job of weed control. You know, keeping those weeds, because in the summertime when they're, you know, relatively dormant, the weeds are not. Grasses and the broadleafs and the grasses continue to be a problem.
Okay. Remember, we like to hear from you. Here's how to send an email or letter for future shows.
Send us an email with your questions and a photo or two. The address is familyplot@wkno.org. Or if you'd rather send a letter, the mailing address is WKNO Attention Family Plot, 7151 Cherry Farms Road, Cordova, Tennessee. The zip is 38016. We're looking forward to hearing from you.
All right, now we have some email questions. And Mr. Jimmy, this one is just for you. It says, my roses have bright red leaves and many thorns. What's wrong with it?
Well, we're seeing more and more of that lately. It's called witch's broom.
Okay.
If you have a plant with this on it, the only recourse you have is to dig it up, get rid of it.
Wow.
If you're trimming your roses and you run into this and you cut a rose bush that's got this on it, I suggest that you sterilize your pruners before you go to another bush. You have an excellent picture of it there. Mm-hmm. Red thorns, red growth, bushy growth. It's supposedly caused by a mite that is blown in that puts a virus into that plant.
Okay. Now, is this the same thing as rose rosette?
It is rosette. Okay. That's the technical name for it. We call it witch's broom.
Witch's broom. Okay. and I see why. Okay. Look, here's our next question. The leaves on my pear trees have turned black and are hanging from the tree. What's causing that, Mr. D?
That's called by fire blight. It's a common disease that's spread by bacteria, common in cool, wet conditions, and it'll attack both the fruiting pears and the ornamental pears, apples, anything that's related. It's a kind of a hard problem to try to take care of. If you have a history of a problem with fire blight, the best way to control it is by using a spray. Now, it's not a fungus disease, so fungicides don't work. It's not a bug, so insecticides don't work. So we have to use a bactericide or an antibiotic. And streptomycin sulfate is pretty much the only one that's available to use. Mm-hmm. Now, if you've got a problem with fire blight right now, it's too late to do that. You need to spray during bloom, and it will probably take about three applications, early bloom, mid bloom, and late bloom, in order to control fire blight. And so if you've got a problem this year, pretty much the only thing that you can do is at this point, you know, we're quite a bit past bloom on our pears, you can go in there and you prune that dead tissue out. If you do, like you said, Mr. Moser, you do need to dip your pruning shears in a 10% solution of bleach, because if you don't, you can spread that bacteria yourself. Over fertilization and over pruning around bloom time can actually spread the disease, because the insects like plant bugs and stink bugs that have piercing, sucking mouth parts will go, and they like to go to the damaged tissue where you did the pruning. Right. That attracts them, and they will spread the disease. So you might need to use an insecticide. Don't do anything to encourage succulent growth, because this disease is attracted to succulent growth. So over pruning and over fertilization can help aggravate the situation. Take out any water sprouts, you know, as soon as you can, mm-hmm. and break those off, because they tend to have more succulent growth.
Okay.
But it's kind of a pretty tough and expensive problem to have.
Pretty tough. Okay, the next question is this. What sort of fertilizer should I use on my strawberry bed, since we just got through talking about strawberries?
Complete fertilizer.
Complete, okay.
Our growers, commercial growers, will put out a complete fertilizer in the fall when they plant the strawberries.
Okay.
And then during the growing season, they are, through their irrigation system, they are injecting nitrogen fertilizer.
Okay.
So just a complete fertilizer, not a lot of a, like 888 is required. Soil test and sure. fertilize according to your soil test.
Sure. And speaking of soil test, the next question is just about that. It says, how often should I get my soil tested? And that's usually every 3 to 5 years.
That's right.
It's what we recommend.
Right. Don't have to do it every year.
That's right.
Roses do it every year.
Roses do it every year.
So we fertilize a lot, they're heavy feeders.
Okay. No. So roses, if you're growing roses, you need to do that every year. Good one. Okay. Now, how do you control squash bugs? Since we did talk about vegetable gardening last week, squash bugs.
Squash bugs are, you know, they're related to stink bugs. They're in the insect order Heteroptera. Have piercing, sucking mouth parts. They're strong flyers. They're tough bugs. They're a little harder to kill than some of the other critters that are out there. The pyrethrins, synthetic pyrethrins, and permethrin, which is will take them out. Matter of fact, I've got squash bug bifenthrin is one of the synthetics, and esfenvalerate is another synthetic pyrethrin that will work, and then permethrin. And all of these come in a lot of different formulations. Just make sure those are in the active ingredients.
Okay. And here again, make sure that people are reading the label.
Follow the label directions.
Make sure that you do that. All right, the next question is, how do you control tomato hornworms?
Tomato hornworm. The easiest and probably the safest material to use to control tomato hornworms is BT, Bacillus thuringiensis. It comes in under the trade name of Dipel or Javelin or several different trade names that are out there.
That's some great pictures.
You need, if you wait until the hornworm is 3 or 4 inches long, you've already got a lot of damage on your tomatoes. So you need to start, if you had a history of problem, you need to start early. Now, there are a lot of other insecticides that will work, but the BT will not kill any of the beneficial insects,
right.
and that's what I recommend. Some of the other insecticides that are on our list are Carbaryl, the synthetic pyrethrins like cyfluthrin and bifenthrin are also listed on our recommended list. The good thing about all of these materials, not only will it control the tomato hornworm, it'll also control the tomato fruit worm, so you're taking care of two pests when you use those.
Okay. With the tomato hornworm, I know from time to time you see some white cocoons attached to the back of those hornworms. What is that?
That's a little parasitic wasp. I have pictures of that on my phone. I had one in my backyard. It's a parasitic wasp that has laid an egg in that hornworm, and that little cocoon is about to hatch out, and an adult parasitic moth will fly out of that and go look for another hornworm. So if you have a hornworm that has a lot of those little cocoons on its back, leave it alone. It's probably not going to do you a lot more damage, and it is a beneficial insect-producing machine.
Mm-hmm.
So leave them be.
Leave them be, huh? Mm-hmm. How about going back to the squash bugs, is there anything out there as far as another beneficial insect that will control squash bugs that you know of, just out of curiosity?
Just man with two bricks when you smack them together, but you got to watch your thumbs.
Okay.
You mash your thumbs.
Get your thumbs out the way.
Right. I don't know of anything that eats squash bugs or stink bugs.
Wow. Okay. Because I know last year there was a lot of questions about, you know, squash bugs on pumpkins, you know, and I was just wondering, is there any beneficial insect that can control squash bugs?
You know, there may be some birds, but I'm not aware of anything that's of any real value.
Wow. Okay. Now, something else, too, that you always mention when you do your talk about insects and vegetable gardening, with the tomato hornworm, don't they have those little V-stripes along the body?
Most of the hornworms that I see on tomatoes are actually the tobacco hornworm.
Okay.
You have the tobacco hornworm and the tomato hornworm that are very, very closely related. And the way that you can tell the difference is the tomato hornworm has a V on its back. Let's see the picture. That's a tobacco hornworm that we're seeing on the, because it just has the slash.
Okay.
Tomato hornworm actually has a V. There you are. There's a tomato hornworm. So you see there's a little bit of difference, but they do the same amount of damage and the same, insecticide to BT will take care of both of them. Okay. Remember, wow, I could have had a V8, and you can remember which is which.
Which is which.
Right. They'll eat a tomato vine down.
That's right, because you have a vegetable garden also.
I do.
Correct? So you've probably seen some of these hornworms and squash bugs and things. How do you control them?
I pick them off.
Okay, you pick them off.
Yeah, kind of hard
you
to
don't
find.
See, you don't see too many of them, but if you'll follow the stem and the droppings there, you can usually locate them pretty easy.
All right.
Pick them off, and they make good fish bait.
Oh, good fish bait.
I need to remember that.
Look, we had a good show here today.
I tell you. It's a big old catfish with a hornworm. It's a tomato hornworm.
Well, look, that's all the time we have for today. Be sure to join us next week. And remember, you can send us an email or letter with your gardening questions. I'm Chris Cooper. And I'll see you next time on The Family Plot, gardening in the Mid-South. Be safe.
Production funding for The Family Plot, Gardening in the Mid-South, is provided by Goodwin's Landscape and Garden Center in Germantown since 1943 and continuing to offer its plants for successful gardening with 7 greenhouses and 3 acres of plants, plus comprehensive landscape services. Goodwin's Landscape and Garden Center.